Thank you. Well, thanks again for coming, and thanks, as always, to the friends of the Bedford Public Library for doing as much as they do and providing particularly delicious desserts today. So I invite you all to partake, especially at our little break, which will come along in 45 or 50 minutes or so. We don't have a clock up here anymore. What happened to the clock?
Behind the door.
So behind the door?
Yeah.
Okay. I have no idea of knowing what time it is, but... Oh, it does. I can look right back there. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, the topic for today is the series of events that happened in the years following the Great Leap Forward, in which, as we saw last time, Mao has suffered a real loss of stature and prestige, especially among his high-level fellows in the Communist Party in Beijing. The Great Leap Forward had been not just a humanitarian disaster, but also a real economic disaster. And anybody in the know, especially in Beijing, knew what a catastrophe it had been. So after 1962, just for a while, Mao was in a state of semi-eclipse in Beijing. He had certainly not retired from his positions at the head of the party, but he was not engaged, as he had been before, in the day-to-day operations of the government. Deng Xiaoping, who we'll meet later as the ruler of China as much as anybody was in the 1980s, Liu Shaoqi, who was one of Mao's comrades on the Long March and who had helped persuade him to give up the worst of the Great Leap Forward programs, and especially General Lin Pao, all three of those men began to administer the state to a far greater extent than they had before the Great Leap Forward, while Mao went back into a certain kind of semi-retirement. But he was always prepared to reassert himself at the head of affairs in China, and the way he proposed to do it would be the series of events known as the Cultural Revolution, which is what we'll talk about today. And so our story for today begins in the middle of the 1960s, 1964, 1965 or so, as Mao was wondering, why had the Great Leap Forward failed? Why had it been that China did not emerge as a leading industrial power the way he had planned it to as a consequence of the five-year plan that gave rise to the Great Leap Forward? And we know the reasons for that. The whole program was mismanaged from the beginning, and it was also very badly conceived. But in Mao's mind, that could not be the explanation. Mao had come to believe in his own cult of personality. The idea that he could be wrong and monstrously wrong about something was not something he was going to easily admit. And so he came to believe that the problem in China, the problem that had given rise to the disasters of the Great Leap Forward, was not economic in nature, not political in nature, but rather cultural in nature. China, Mao began to feel, was too addicted to old ways of thinking, pre-communist ways of acting and thinking that for him now had to be eradicated. And to eradicate those old ways was to restore Mao to a position of eminence in China, as he believed he was born to exercise, and to achieve that destruction of the old ways of thinking, old ways of acting. He was going to take advantage of the young people of China, people in their teens and early 20s, who he believed could be absolutely loyal to him, who would have no loyalty to the traditional communist bureaucracy that had arisen since 1949, who would have no loyalty to those among Mao in the communist leadership, but because of years and years of the cult of personality, would have loyalty to him, to Mao. And to help cement that loyalty, by 1965, he had published this. And this is the famous Little Red Book, which you've all heard of, which one of our patrons was kind enough to bring in. This is actually a 1966 English language edition of the Little Red Book with a foreword by General Lin Pao, who had helped win the Civil War on behalf of the Communists in the 1940s, and who was Mao's second in command by the middle of the 1960s. So this was the book that contained most of what Mao wanted to say, especially to the young. And the idea was all wisdom, all political knowledge that matters would be contained in this book. And a central part of the cult of personality was now not just going to be the image of Mao, which you see in this poster from 1966, but also the sayings of Mao contained in the famous Little Red Book, which we'll get back to in a little while. So in 1966, Mao launched this war, as it really was, against the four olds, as he put it. Old thoughts, old culture, old customs, old habits. All of which amounted to what he thought as the same thing, ways of dragging China down from where China had to be under Mao's leadership. Everything had to be centered on Mao's personality and thoughts, printed, as I said, here in the Little Red Book, which was printed in over a billion copies in the middle of the 1960s, one of the largest printings of any book in the history of the world, distributed all over China so that everybody would have the opportunity of having one, along with 2 billion badges distributed all over China, bearing the likeness of Mao's own face to be worn preferably by everybody. The little red book would come to be such an object of veneration in some parts of China, especially among the young, that it was said to be able to cure illnesses. And in one case, was credited with allowing a man to rise from the dead. One case, at least, that we know of that was published in the newspapers. Telephone operators now, at the beginning of the Cultural Revolution, this restoration of the height of Mao's cult of personality in opposition to any who might challenge him in the communist state of China. Telephone operators would be told to answer the phone by saying, "Long live Chairman Mao." Mao's portrait would be in every workplace, and workers would be taught to bow 3 times before the portrait, before beginning work. And that's why the movement had come to be known as the Cultural Revolution, a way of changing habits and thoughts among the people of China so that loyalty to Mao would be unquestioned, and only then, Mao believed, could the country go forward as he had planned for it to do in the Great Leap Forward. The idea was to exclude the leading members of the Communist Party in China, to avoid what Mao thought of as the mistakes Khrushchev had made in the Soviet Union, elevating the bureaucracy of the Communist Party over the old cult of personality that Stalin had established. We want none of that in China, Mao believed. The thing to do would be to go off in a Maoist direction where all loyalty would be centered on him. And indeed, communists who Mao thought were not sufficiently dedicated to him would be specific targets of the movement to come. All over China, local officials, communist officials, would come under heavy criticism. Mao's allies would now go, beginning in 1966, to the universities, such as Beijing University, and to the high schools, and start rousing the students there to organize into groups that became known as Red Guards. The Red Guards would then be urged to draw up posters praising Mao and criticizing anybody seeking to hold on to the four olds, the old ways that Mao was not combating, and especially members of the Communist Party who supposedly were not doing what Mao wanted. They would be targets of special criticism and attack. Vast numbers of young people all over China now joined these Red Guards, new organizations of students that came to be formed in 1966. In Shanghai, 2.7 million kids joined, putting up 88,000 posters all over Shanghai in the surrounding area. In Xi'an, the great northwestern city of Xi'an in China, so many posters went up criticizing local officials that one girl who was writing 20 posters a day, all by herself, committed suicide under the strain. The Cultural Revolution would always be known for these posters, the works often of the Red Guard, and supposed to demonstrate their loyalty to Mao and loyalty to the principles of the Little Red Book. And the language of these posters had a certain roughness to them, a certain coarseness to them, as Red Guard models also did when they were shouting them in their harangues against people that they were opposing. The Chinese language is one of great subtlety and elegance, and to experience the coarseness of some of the language of the Red Guard in the posters could be very jolting if you respected the Chinese language the way it traditionally is. For example, one of the models of the Red Guard was "beat to a pulp any and all persons who go against Chairman Mao thought." Now here again was the violence, a renewed sense of violence in China that came naturally to Mao, who had always said, for example, that a revolution is not a dinner party. If you wanted to make a new China, it could only be done violently. And that, in essence, was what the Red Guards took to heart, that message. By allying the youth of China to himself, Mao hoped to do a demonstrable revolutionary transformation in the entire country, in which he would be at the center of all things for good. And to demonstrate that he was capable of leading the youth of China, Mao took his famous swim in the Yangtze River in 1966, to show how youthful he was. We'll get to that poor guy in a minute. And here's Mao in the Yangtze. Mao, remember, was somebody who did swim and was proud of his swimming capacity. And to show how youthful he was at the age of 73, how strong he was, in 1966, he took this swim in the Yangtze, and he claimed to have swum across the river, which would win a real trick. It's a really, really wide river, the Yangtze. And he probably didn't do more than a few strokes of the backstroke, which is what he was accustomed to doing, or the side stroke. But there he is in the Yangtze, and that picture was circulated all over China to show the youthfulness of Mao and his worthiness in leading the youth, the Red Guards of China, against the bureaucratic, entrenched communist hierarchy that Mao now distrusted and wanted to assert supremacy over. So to energize this movement, Mao's operatives suspended all classes in the universities and secondary schools of China so that a total of 103 million students were free to go into action as Red Guards. And what they did at universities all over China, they mobilized, and these students would seize their teachers and often stick pointed dunce caps on their heads, or sometimes waste paper baskets. And this is sort of what it could look like. This guy here is not a teacher. He's a functionary in Harbin in Manchuria. But the idea was to humiliate them, to demean them, and to punish them for holding on to any remnant of the old ways of China, the four olds that the Cultural Revolution was dedicated against. And sometimes the teachers were made to kneel while the students kicked them, splattered their faces with black ink on occasion, pulled their hair, stuck posters on their bodies, the posters that the students had made proclaiming the thought of Chairman Mao and the virtues of the Cultural Revolution. And then the teachers would be paraded around in disgrace. Many were then forced to clean toilets at the high school or the university, wherever they had been seized. And this was a terrible thing in Chinese culture, where teachers are enormously respected in the heritage of China. For this to happen to a teacher was unprecedented and humiliating in the extreme. And the teachers who were forced to clean restrooms were the lucky ones. The most unlucky ones might be some of those, for example, who were made to sit on crates of explosives, which were then set on fire so that the arms and legs of teachers would be burst in all directions. They would be retrieved later, some of them, from treetops, limbs of teachers. Now, all attempts to bring the Red Guards under some sort of central control were from the very beginning fruitless. Mao's idea was to create chaos, to shake up China, as he thought had to be happened, through chaotic conditions. And what he thought was something better, something good, something not just centered on him, but something that would allow the genuine modernization of China would come out of that chaos. And this is what he said: great chaos will lead to great order. The demons and monsters will come out by themselves, meaning anybody who might be a threat. All restrictions must be smashed to pieces, he said. We must not restrict the masses. In other words, people in their teens and 20s were now going to be unleashed to do more or less as they pleased, according to the Little Red Book, which was in the hands of every member of the Red Guard throughout the Cultural Revolution. And as these events began, unprecedented events, Zhou Enlai did his best to stay in the background, hoping to escape any bad consequences that might have come from opposing Mao. But other members of the party, like Deng Xiaoping and Liu Shaoqi, as we'll see, were not so lucky. Now, that summer of 1966, Mao appeared periodically, regularly, in Tiananmen Square in front of rallies of hundreds of thousands of Red Guards who would be brought there from all over China in great bus trips so they could see the hero, the great helmsman, Chairman Mao. And as he appeared in front of great crowds, he always wore the red armbands of the Red Guard. And off to the side, made to wear those armbands and looking very sheepish, would be Liu Shaoqi and Deng Xiaoping. And speaking to the crowds was very often Mao's wife. Zheng Cheng met a Mao, who we'll meet in just a minute, and she was a true believer in the Cultural Revolution. There she is on the left. Madame Mao was Mao's fourth wife, I believe. He married her in Yan'an during the war against Japan. He had divorced his third wife, even though his third wife had been injured by one of Chiang Kai-shek's bombs during the Long March. He divorced her and married Jiang Cheng. And she was a former actress and known in her time as a beautiful and accomplished woman. But she was also a woman who held grudges. She held very strong grudges. And Deng Xiaoping, back in Yan'an, had stood up for Mao's third wife. And Madame Mao, Jiang Cheng, never forgot that. And another thing she did not like was Liu Shaoqi had a beautiful wife himself. And she was a little bit jealous of Madame Liu. And that was going to account for some very vicious actions against both Madame Liu and Liu Shaoqi, who had been for a long time at Mao's right hand at the very summit of Chinese communist rule. This would be Zheng's chance to take revenge against those she didn't like. And she seized full advantage of that. Many thought of her as a scorpion, but she could not be disturbed as long as Mao supported her. And when she was addressing huge crowds in Tiananmen Square, she was really in her element. Remember, she was a former actress. And she would talk so that her eyes would seem to pop open with excitement as she was addressing the Red Guards. And her voice would rise to a great shriek, churning the crowd into fits of anger and resentment against all those that Madam Mao didn't like. And just to make sure that she would not be embarrassed by her shady past as an actress back in Shanghai, long before she met Mao, anyone who knew her back then were harassed, arrested, and sometimes tortured. And luckily for her former husband, who was still alive and probably would have been killed during the Cultural Revolution, he was safe in Paris running a restaurant. He didn't have to worry about it, but a lot of other people did. And one thing about her was she got to be in charge of publishing in China during the Cultural Revolution. Nothing was going to get published in China without her say-so. This was published a lot. Friedrich Engels' book was published a lot, but not a whole lot else besides that. A grand total of 124 novels were published in China between 1966 and 1971. That's it. Very little was published, but this was really all you need as far as she was concerned and as far as her husband were concerned, because they were against, according to the jargon of the Cultural Revolution, anything old. So street names were now going to be changed. Anti-revisionism Road was the sample of a new street name you might come across in China. Revisionism being the Khrushchev idea that instead of worshiping a personality, we should get down to the business of building a socialist state. But that was, of course, everything that Mao now opposed, that kind of revisionism. So you saw street names like that. Hong Kong, still in British hands, of course, was now renamed Exile the Imperialist City, or Expel the Imperialist City. Buildings in Shanghai were stripped of carvings, beautiful Art Deco carvings that had been put there in the 1930s. They were foreign, they were old, and they had to go. Mao had been taking English lessons. He stopped that during the Cultural Revolutions. No need for that now. And if a woman was caught with a Western hairstyle, Red Guards would drag her to the barbers and have her hair forcibly cut. So many Red Guards went out to the countryside to attack anything old that the trains in China were now clogged with people going back and forth for political purposes, so that by some measures, 10 million tons of goods were just sitting on the tracks during parts of 1966 and 1967. They couldn't get anywhere to the people who needed them because so many political operatives were going back and forth. Many suspected of having bourgeois, anti-communist, pro-Soviet, pro-Khrushchev sympathies were simply killed. Nobody knows how many, but we do know that in Shanghai, 700 people killed themselves rather than be killed by the Red Guards. I'm gonna beat them to it. The Red Guards were terrorizing the city in 66 and 67, and so there were 700, and at least 700 suicides. And in Tientsin, the great city to the east of Beijing, Tientsin, people routinely threw themselves in the river to die rather than be killed by the Red Guards. So many of them that people were taking fish hooks, putting them in the river and getting out the bodies before they could clog the stream. That's how bad it got to be by the end of 66. Tens of thousands who were not killed were publicly humiliated, beaten in front of great crowds by screaming Red Guards. Nobody was safe. The governor of one province had all his hair torn out for daring to wear it in a style associated with Mao during his days of the Long March. Any sign of non-communism was in trouble. In Harbin, Manchuria, the great Buddhist temple there, where monks had been worshiping for thousands of years, was now the scene of a terrible event, where those same monks who were still at the temple were dragged out and made to carry banners reading, "To hell with the Buddha." The Buddha, his writings are full of dog farts. That's what the banner had to say. And that's the kind of coarseness that those banners too often had that was shocking to people who appreciated Chinese. Children were informing upon their parents. That's the chaos that Mao had now brought into being. And if you owned precious artwork, old artwork from traditional Chinese culture, that was a sign that you were disloyal. That was a sign that you might not be able to be trusted. Red Guards raided apartments where art might be kept. They seized it, they destroyed it, but a lot of it, as we now know, was sent up to Beijing for Madame Zhang, who now sold it on the international market at a profit. Places of great historical value were attacked, vandalized. The birthplace of Confucius, Shandong province, was vandalized. 6,000 pieces of art destroyed at the great monument to Confucius, the great tomb of Confucius in Shandong. The Forbidden City itself in Beijing, the Great Forbidden City, the seat of the emperors, would likely have been destroyed as well had not Zhou Enlai, in a rare bit of defiance, had soldiers there to guard it, and he preserved the Forbidden City for all of us to see. But 400,000 people branded as enemies of Mao, riotists as they were called, were forced to leave the cities and live in the countryside, while the Red Guards took over the apartments that they had to vacate, and artists especially were now forced to devote all their efforts to celebrating the regime. So I'll give you some idea of the kind of thing that happened to people, the kind of people who suffered. This is Liu Shaoqi. We'll meet him in a little while. He's on the right. Every event like this has got to have some kind of scapegoat, some kind of an enemy that you can point to. When Stalin was purging the Communist Party in the Soviet Union, Trotsky was his enemy. Everybody was a Trotskyist. And in the Cultural Revolution, Liu Shaoqi, he's going to be the enemy, who would now be stripped of his positions and would be the scapegoat of everything that went wrong and some awful stuff, as we'll see, was about to happen to him. And then you didn't have to be, of course, an art lover to be horrified by this sort of thing. These are bits of painting on Chinese furniture, and this is the sort of thing that routinely happened. You come across a painting like this as a Red Guard, and you scrape it out, you deface it, you blot it out somehow, and you make sure that its true beauty could never be appreciated again. These are one of the many examples of cultural vandalism that we still have access to and that you can still see. One of many I could hundreds, perhaps thousands of temples, for example, were utterly destroyed. And the tragedy for human beings, of course, was quite as great and greater. This is one of China's great authors in the mid-20th century. This is Ding Ling, who was a woman, a crusader for women's rights, who had been in Yan'an with Mao, Zhou, and the rest of them during the war. And she had often criticized Mao for not taking seriously women's rights. He proclaimed women's rights, but there were very few women in positions of power in the Communist Party. And she had the courage to take him to task for that. She wrote novels. She actually won the Stalin Prize, highest prize in the communist world, in the middle of the 1950s. But she was an intellectual, and so during the Cultural Revolution, she was mercilessly subjected to constant Red Guard harangues, which she had to endure for hours. And what they would do is they would make you assume the airplane position. That's the airplane position. You have to hold out your arms like this, sometimes for hours. If you couldn't keep them up, they would just hit them up for you and beat you if you couldn't take the stress in the pain. And she had to do that for extended periods of time, spent 5 years in jail. And this is her long after she was finally released when the Cultural Revolution was over. And there are many examples of that. An opera star back in Shanghai, somebody that Madame Mao knew, Jiang Cheng, somebody that she knew, she really wanted revenge against her because of something she had done back in the 30s. So she found out where this opera star happened to be living in semi-retirement, and she vandalized, made sure the house was vandalized. The opera star lost her job, which was in the performing arts, and instead of performing the task that she thought she was suited for, she was now made to be a common servant, a common cleaner of houses. And eventually she couldn't stand it, and like so many others, she made one last meal for her son and then walked to another part of the house and killed herself because of the demeaning nature of what had to happen to her. And this is Lao She. Lao She was a respected novelist and historian, journalist in China. And he was 67 years old, an intellectual during the Cultural Revolution, when he was taken by the Red Guards to a courtyard of a former Buddhist temple. He was very sick at this time, but they took him to the courtyard of the temple anyway. And there he was made to stand up in stifling heat in the airplane position, while Red Guards whipped him with leather straps, spit on him for untold hours. And when he finally went home, the blood on his clothes was so thickly congealed that his wife had to cut it off with a knife. That's how bad it was. He was 67 years old. And they told him that he now had to go around town with a banner proclaiming himself a counter-revolutionary. Had to go around counter-revolutionary. And he couldn't stand the humiliation, so when he got the next chance, he walked out towards a nearby lake, walked in, and drowned himself. And here's somebody else whose story is particularly poignant. And this is a woman who was much younger during the Cultural Revolution. I think she was in her 30s or maybe early 40s. This is a Zhang Jiqin, who was a party worker, a bit of a part-time author, and also somebody with her own mind, somebody known as a person of learning, who was imprisoned by the Red Guards in solitary confinement. And she had the courage to talk back to the Red Guards. She had no use for the Cultural Revolution. She had no use for Mao back then, and she made her views known. And as a result, the Red Guards told the guards at the jail that they would be rewarded by torturing her and raping her, which they did repeatedly while she was imprisoned. And in the end, she would not recant. This is what she said. "It is better to live with honesty than with flattery. I've never thought in my life of enslaving anybody, so I won't let anybody degrade me." She stood up for herself until the end, until Madame Mao ordered her to be executed. And they were afraid she would speak on the way to be shot. So what they had to do was break her jaw on the way to the execution. And she was finally beheaded, actually, in 1975, at the very, very end of Madame Mao and Mao's rule. She is now a bit of a heroine among dissidents in China, as an example of what you have to live up to. Somebody who somehow found the courage to speak her mind despite everything. And there she is. We should try to remember her. That's Zhang Zhiqin. Now, all of these decisions are often made on the ground where people were whipped, where they were beaten, often killed. All of these decisions were often made in a very decentralized way. Sometimes Madame Mao would give the orders, but it was usually Red Guards just deciding what they wanted to do, and things would just get out of hand depending on how they were feeling. And the question always is, why? Why would all this anger, violent anger, be coming up from the young, by people in their teens and early 20s? And one must remember that they had all grown up, ever since the 1940s, with images of Mao as the faultless statesman, the great helmsman. They believed, perhaps, having been raised with this idea, that he was infallible, could do no wrong. That's the success of the cult of personality. Many of them had grown up, especially when they were in their early teens, perhaps, in conditions of near starvation, hardship. Who are they going to blame for lack of prospects in life? Who are they going to blame for the terrible things that they'd often had to experience during the Great Leap Forward? If you can't blame Mao, you blame the people that Mao blames. And perhaps they felt that this was a way to shake up those above them and maybe make things easier for them as they were rising in life. It was all too easy, perhaps, to credit that what Mao said might be true. And so they acted. And that's when we finally get to Liu Shaoqi, who I showed you just a little while ago. He's going to be the Trotsky of the Cultural Revolution. He's going to be the one Mao's really going to blame. And finally, his time came in 1967 when he was arrested, having been denounced by his own daughter. His own daughter put up a poster nearby their apartment saying, "Witness the despicable soul of Liu Shaoqi," who had been at Mao's side ever since the Long March. He was forced to stand up for hours while the Red Guard harangued in his face, brandished the little red book in his face, spit in his face sometimes. They would not let him sleep. They shouted at all hours towards his bedroom window while dozens of people were found to testify that Liu Shaoqi was an American agent. Not a shred of documentary evidence, despite 2 million documents being gone through, ever said anything of the kind or shown anything of the kind. But he was denounced this way, finally imprisoned, and at the same time, Madame Mao has special plans for his wife, who, remember, she didn't like Madame Liu, known to be an attractive woman, who had gone abroad with Liu Shaoqi on visits to various heads of state. And on one of those trips, she went to Indonesia, and she wore one of the traditional tight-fitting Chinese silk dresses. And Madame Mao did not like the idea that she was wearing this beautiful, tight-fitting silk dress, traditional in China. And so she decided to punish Madame Liu for trying, perhaps, to assert herself as somebody greater, more graceful than Madame Mao herself. And so what happened to Madame Liu, who Mao had known, by the way, for about 20 years, what happened to her was she was taken by the Red Guards. She was forced down on the floor. And against her will, they took off what she was wearing, and they tried to fit that same silk red dress on her, forcibly and violently. And then what they did was they took her outside, where there were about 10,000 Red Guards gathered in the square, and they shouted at her while she froze in that thin silk dress in the winter of 1967. And all of it orchestrated for vengeance, petty vengeance by Madame Mao. "You have violated Chairman Mao's instructions about not struggling against the people," the Red Guard said. And they even attacked her for daring to light a cigarette for the president of Indonesia. That's somehow, perhaps, showing that she was getting too big for her own britches, as we might say in this country. And for that, she was punished. And eventually, her husband was sent out on the countryside to work for a while. Then he was brought back to prison. Mandam Liu Xiaoqi. They were both in prison for a while. They're in the same prison, but they weren't allowed to see each other until one particular day came when they just happened to be out exercising at the same time, and Mandam Liu rushed to embrace her husband one last time, for she knew he was sickening. She knew he was dying. And they were clearly separated by the guards after a last moment of embrace. Liu Xiaoqi was put on trial. He only had 7 teeth left by then. He was very sick, and he was denounced by all hands as a terrible traitor, even though there's no evidence of that. He broke down and he died before they could execute him after a trial that was televised all over a fascinated China. Madam Liu survived until she was 85. She only died in 2006, long after her husband, Liu Xiaoqi, was resurrected by the modern Communist Party as somebody who was much better than Mao said he was. But almost nobody dared to protest. Now, one of the few examples other than her, that I found of somebody who actually directly protested and tried to indicate their hatred for what was happening in China was a young woman named Wang Rongfen. And she'd been studying German, and that made her a target of the Red Guards. You're studying German, you're studying foreign things. And so naturally, she was going to get into trouble. But before she could, she actually wrote a letter to Mao. So 1967, she wrote a letter to Mao, and she told him that the Cultural Revolution was not a mass movement. The Cultural Revolution was a case of the masses being tricked and brutalized and had to stop. And she said that this is a case of one man manipulating the people, that is Mao. And she told Mao in this letter, you're no better than Hitler. You're no better than Hitler. And she signed in her name. And she mailed the letter. And after she mailed the letter, she went and she found a bunch of insecticide. And there was plenty of insecticide in China because they were used against the pest during the Great Leap Forward. She found a bunch of insecticide. And she walked over to the Soviet embassy, and in front of the Soviet embassy, she took all the insecticide and she drank it in an attempt to commit suicide. She drank 4 bottles of insecticide, but her suicide attempt failed. She was tortured and thrown in jail, but she wasn't killed, and she finally got out of the 1980s. Well, the list of atrocities during the Cultural Revolution goes on, but one thing that did happen that was quite unusual was Mao's great enemy by now really was the Soviet Union. And he was terrified that the Soviet Union would invade, attack China. And the Red Guards were taught that the Soviet Union is the real enemy. They're the ones who revised communism. They're the ones who've lost the true force of communism the way it could be if the masses had genuinely rallied behind a great leader. And so the Soviets were the ones who had to look out their embassy every day and see Red Guards parading and parading and shouting at them and shouting at them. If you were a Soviet diplomat, you'd have your tires slashed repeatedly if you were dumb enough to leave the car out in the street. And so if you were in the Soviet embassy, you almost never left the embassy now. As long as the Cultural Revolution was going on, you stayed in the embassy as long as you could and barely went out at all. But it wasn't just them. It was also the British embassy in Beijing. Now, the British consul in Shanghai was hit by Red Guards, spat on, and smeared with glue after the consulate in Shanghai was ransacked by Red Guards. But it was even worse in Beijing, where the embassy was. The Red Guards were furious that Hong Kong was still a British possession, among other things. So what they decided to do was blockade the embassy, laid under siege. And the personnel at the embassy were used to not going outside. Now they're under siege, hoping that the diplomats work this out somehow. But finally, the Red Guards, just as the Iranians did in 1979 to our embassy, the Red Guards decided to attack the British embassy in Beijing. And the British personnel were in there. They were watching a movie. They were playing bridge. They had a bunch of file cabinets up against the door. But it didn't do any good. The attack came. They got into the embassy shouting, kill, 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 kill. And they took members of the embassy into their custody, beat them up. They found the senior official there, the senior guy who happened to be at the embassy, and they, after beating him badly with a bamboo stake, the Red Guards made him stand in a box outside in front of a bunch of people, and they told him to shout, long live Chairman Mao. Long live Mao. You shout, long live Mao. Long live Mao. And he wouldn't do it. So, long live Mao. He wouldn't do it. Very brave guy. He kept refusing to do so. So they dragged him through the streets, and he thought he was going to die. Thought they were probably going to kill him. They dragged him through the streets, as it turned out, to the Albanian embassy, one of Mao's few good friends in the world, Albania. And that's where they left him. And the whole time he was being dragged by the Red Guards, he was trying to calm himself, and he recited passages from the Aeneid. He recited Virgil all the way down towards the Albanian embassy, which gives us another reason why education is a good thing. It will help you in these times. It will help you when you are under great stress to remind yourself of the great figures of the past. And he survived, as did a lot of other lucky people. Now, embassies being attacked. The last time embassies were attacked in Beijing was 1898. And that was the Boxer Rebellion. And the last time this happened, Germany, Japan, the United States, Great Britain, France, they all sent armies into China to punish them for this. But this is 1967. It's not going to happen now. China was too powerful, and so the Red Guards got away with this. The only people who were in a position to stop this were Mao himself, if he decided that it was time, and also the army, the Chinese army. And what happened by late 67, early 68, was the army was getting nervous about all this. The Red Guard was in control of much of China, and the army believed that it was getting to a point where maybe the Red Guard could not be put back in that box, if Mao ever thought that was a good idea. Liu Shaoqi was in jail, about to be executed, although he died before that could happen. Deng Xiaoping was now sent to work in a tractor factory. Ironically, he had worked in a tractor factory back in France 50 years before when he was traveling there. Now he's back in a tractor factory, hoping to learn, Mao thought, how to think like a commoner, like a peasant. But other people who were there, still around Mao, were very nervous about all this. Is there any way to control these Red Guards? And the army especially felt that the time had come, perhaps, to put a cap on this, to quell this, while there was still time. Many people had suffered by now. Consider Deng Xiaoping. His brother, Deng Guizhou, killed himself because he was attacked by Red Guards. And his own son was a brilliant physicist. Deng Xiaoping had a brilliant physicist son studying at Beijing University. The Red Guards caught him. They tortured him. And at the university, he actually was running from Red Guards up on the roof. Red Guards were chasing him on the roof. He jumped off the roof to escape the Red Guards and spent the rest of his life a paraplegic because of what happened to him. And Deng Xiaoping knew this. Others knew other people that this had happened to. Members of the army had people that this sort of thing was happening to. Maybe the time had come to put a stop to this. And what finally happened was Lin Pao and the army especially came to Mao and pled that some sort of order be restored to China. And in 1968, finally Mao decided that might be a good idea by now. And the army began to go into places in China and in some cases fight battles with the Red Guard to keep them under control and to stop the worst of this chaos. And finally they did so that by 1968 and especially 1969, the Red Guards were told, leave the cities, leave the towns, go out in the countryside and help rebuild China there. 12 million Red Guards went out to the countryside. And in the meantime, the high schools, the universities, most of them were not open during all these years. And that's why, for many people, this is the lost generation of China. People who didn't get a chance to get an education, people who didn't get a chance to learn a skill. They were either Red Guards or they just couldn't go to school because the whole thing was shut down. And that would be true even into the early 1970s. But at least for the time being, the worst of the Red Guard terror was over, and the army, with eventually Mao's blessing, had reasserted control. But for his purposes, he had done it. He had rid the upper reaches of the communist echelon in Beijing of any possible opposition to him. Liu Shaoqi was dead in prison. Deng Xiaoping was still off at the tractor factory. And Zhou Enlai, as usual, was still around, but in no position even to think of challenging the great helmsman. Mao and Madame Mao now ran the state. And any loss of stature that Mao suffered after the Great Leap Forward was now very much a thing of the past. The Cultural Revolution would not officially end until just before Mao's death, but the worst of it was over by 1969, because by then the army and Mao had other things to worry about, not just the Red Guard and what they might do, but also the Soviet Union, because there were now border incidents and fighting going on between the Soviets and the Chinese on the Ussuri River and also in Xinjiang province off to the west. And if anything was going to perhaps interfere with Chinese efforts to come to grips with this new crisis, it might be disorder caused by the Red Guards. So there was now something new to worry about, and that would mean the end, finally, of the worst phases of the communist Cultural Revolution. But what I would suggest is the significance of all this is at least partly this, that disorder that the Red Guards caused, 66, 67, especially those 2 years in 68, the constant sight of uncontrolled young people brandishing the little red book into the faces of those they didn't like. A series of events that may, according to some estimates, have resulted in the deaths of 1.5 million people all over China. That disorder, that uncontrolled disorder, was never to be forgotten by the people who lived through it, some of whom would become leaders in China by the 1980s and 1990s. And the example of allowing some sort of power center, uncontrolled completely from the top, which is the case with the Red Guards, would not be repeated again. And if you wonder why the modern communist leadership is so intent upon maintaining absolute power and not allowing centers of dissent to form anywhere else in the country, the memory of the Red Guards may play a role in that insistence on maintaining stability at all costs. And so it would be that when China would alter its economy completely by the 1980s, it would do so on the understanding that was very important in Deng Xiaoping's mind, that that economic modernization would take place within the context of rigid political stability. No more opening things up. Whatever the Red Guards were, no more of that. And what is the lesson of history? We have a French Revolution because the king allowed the Estates General to form. We get an American Revolution because the king was in no position to prevent the formation of the Continental Congress. We got a Russian Revolution because we had the Soviets that were formed as workers' organizations that would control communications and industry after the Tsar was toppled in 1917. In every single case, the real revolution happened because those centers of authority were there that resentment could rally around. And that's what the Red Guards might have been. Mao himself was worried that the Red Guards would get a taste of power and maybe turn against him someday. And to stop that, to nip that in the bud, they had to go. And here we have again the answer to what many people wonder. Why not allow some center of dissent in China, some organized, independent political activity? Why not loosen things up? Because that might be the signal for something very deep. That might be a signal for revolution. You give people a way to rally that's legal, and they'll take it. And the Red Guards would be a living and very close reminder of what happens when you let slip, just a little bit, central authority. It can happen again. So we have to cover the question of what happened to Mao. He died in 1976 under very interesting circumstances. So I thought I would talk a bit about that. After you get a chance to have some sweets. Have some coffee, have some sweets. Yeah, very much. In the big picture, not such a bad idea. If you wanted genuine equality and revolution, maybe you did have to begin with culture. Maybe you did have to re-educate people. Maybe you did have to take people and have them do odd jobs and menial tasks and get them to think in a certain way. And it was not all that unusual, at least for a while, to go into a rather radical students' dorm room and maybe see not just a poster of Che Guevara, which was more likely, but maybe a poster of Mao. And there were faculty members who thought that maybe Mao had the genuine revolutionary potential that no longer could be sought for in the Soviet Union, for example. But for a few of those, the atrocity of the Cultural Revolution were well known. You knew what was going on. You knew the sayings of Mao. You knew the basic program. But the worst of it was underreported in the West. Few people knew just how bad it was until a little bit later. And it was bad. Those were years when middle schools were turned into prisons in some parts of China, when the words "Long Live Mao" were sometimes written in the blood of those who were attacked on street walls and building walls in various cities. It's a tough, difficult, and treacherous time to live. But one story that always struck me as a very poignant one had to do with a Chinese doctor who had left China just before the Cultural Revolution and got his medical degree in Canada. He wanted to be an obstetrician. And so after studying a long time in Canada, by 1969, he felt he was ready to go home. And he could have stayed in Canada. He could have made some money treating women in hospitals there. But he was a patriot, and he wanted to go back to China. He wanted to work on women in China and increase the knowledge of proper birthing techniques there. So he wanted to do his duty to his own people. So he went back to China, and very shortly after he got back, at the very end of the height of the Cultural Revolution, he was arrested by Red Guards, and they decided that a good thing to do to him was to make him stay in a morgue. So he wasn't even put in a prison. He was put in a morgue where it's freezing cold, and he wasn't given much to wear. And for years, he had to live at the morgue, surrounded by these dead bodies. And he felt that he could prevent himself from freezing to death if he could just find shrouds here and there. He was dressing himself as best he could. But what he was really afraid of was going crazy, because he couldn't leave the morgue. And so what he would do is he would, every night when the other workers had left, he would get up on a table, and he would stomp around a bit to keep himself warm. And the whole time he was on this table, he would keep reciting in English the Gettysburg Address. So 47 years ago, our fathers. So he knew the Gettysburg Address. He'd just keep reciting it, reciting it, reciting it. And he stayed sane doing that. And that kind of thing should never happen to anybody when your talents can't be put to use. You're put in the morgue, you got to stand at the table, and you got to keep your own sanity. That's a sign of a society that has taken a wrong turn. In this case, led, unfortunately, by Mao. So when the army began to keep control of the Red Guards, and when the worst of these upheavals were over by the early 1970s, the big question remained for Mao, what about the Soviet Union? He was obsessed with fear that the Soviets would subject China to a nuclear attack. He had a big bunker built for himself. Once he actually had Beijing evacuated by all officials because he thought a nuclear strike was imminent from the Soviet Union. And there was fighting on the border, and the Chinese actually captured a top-secret Soviet T-62 tank on the island on the Ussuri River during one of these engagements. And the United States was paying a very close attention to that. And that is the origin of the famous rapprochement between the United States and China. Mao decided he needed the United States as a counterweight to China, to the Soviet Union, at the same time that we felt we needed the Chinese as a counterweight to the Soviets, and maybe a way to get a decent settlement in Vietnam. So maybe if we could get closer to China, we could play them off against the Soviets took up against the Chinese, and they both had influence over North Vietnam, and maybe that would be a way to try to get a peace deal. And that's one reason Nixon made his famous visit to China, which everybody watched on TV, one of the most famous events of 1972. By then, however, something really big had happened. Lin Pao, who had been Mao's right-hand man, who had written the foreword to the Little Red Book, and who was supposed to be Mao's successor, had come under a great deal of suspicion from Madame Mao, and there was some talk of him maybe getting arrested, and maybe him being the latest casualty of this Cultural Revolution. And for one reason or another, he got in an airplane, left Beijing, and nobody knows what happened next. The wreck of the plane was found in Mongolia. The plane crashed, maybe on the way to the Soviet Union. Maybe he was defecting, but maybe he was on his way to Taiwan and taking a roundabout route. We still don't know to this day what he was up to. But he went down in a plane crash before he could be arrested, before Madame Mao could have her way. And now the great question was, who's going to succeed Mao? He was sick. Among other things, he had a venereal disease because he was quite reckless with younger women. I had no problem infecting them long after he knew he had venereal disease. And he also had Parkinson's disease. He had lung problems. The month before he actually met Nixon, he had a stroke. He was in terrible health, even by the early 1970s. And everybody knew he's not going to live forever. Now, who's going to succeed him? And many people in China thought the logical choice was Zhou Enlai. Zhou Enlai had suffered during the Cultural Revolution, too. His two adopted children were murdered by the Red Guards. But many people in China respected Zhou Enlai. His wife could not have children, but Zhou Enlai loved her, would not divorce her. Liu Shaoqi, Mao, they're all multi-divorced. But Zhou Enlai stuck by his wife, and he was widely respected for that. And many people in China thought the worst excesses of the Great Leap Forward and even the Cultural Revolution, if you were older, of course, that was not a good time for you, might have been avoided if Zhou Enlai had been in charge. He was somebody who was looked up to. So what if he could succeed? Wow. A lot of people thought that might be such a pretty good idea. But then what happened was January 1976, while this man, Deng Xiaoping, was still off at the tractor, well, he was actually renovated by now. He was back in Beijing, but didn't have any power. He was living on his own. While Deng Xiaoping was out of the tractor factory, Zhou Enlai died January 1976. And after he died, 3 months later, during the Great Xingming Festival, where all over China, in the first week of April, people commemorate their ancestors, those who they love who are no longer with us. They commemorate them by decorating tombs and lighting bits of paper on fire. You've probably seen some of the Xingming Festival. What a lot of people in Beijing did was they went to Tiananmen Square, and they left monuments to Zhou. It's 3 months after he died. And Madame Mao ordered that those monuments be cleaned up. She got them all out. It's just trash. She had no use for Zhou Enlai. Madame Mao wanted to secede Mao herself. And so what happened next was, this is an example of the Xingming Festival. What happened next was when people noticed that all that stuff had been cleaned out of Tiananmen Square, by some estimates, the next day, early April 1976, 2 million people at one time or another went into Tiananmen Square and protested. Nothing like this had happened since 1949. Mass protests against mostly Madam Mao and the idea that she might succeed the chairman. So here was not an uprising, but something close to it. And Madam Mao had to order in the troops, and there was bloodshed in the square, as there would be again in 1989. But that seemed to indicate that Madam Mao was not too popular, and that gave rise to the hopes of Deng Xiaoping. It can't be long now, when Mao died, who's going to succeed? And a man named Hua Guofeng was chosen at almost the last minute by Mao, but he was a bit of a non-entity, nobody knew much about him, and that's why Madam Mao thought in the end that she would probably take charge. But what ultimately happened was Mao, in September of 1976, did die. He needed desperately the attention of top-flight ultra-modern medicine, and Madam Mao didn't believe in any of that, and so he didn't get the attention that he really needed by then. And he died in the second week of September 1976, and almost immediately, Hua Guofeng, within a month, was able to seize control. Madam Mao and the rest of what came to be called the Gang of Four were arrested, eventually put on trial, and 2 years later, because Hua Guofeng wasn't much of a charismatic personality, Deng Xiaoping, by 1978, could take charge himself. And the rest is history. Deng, famous for saying, you probably all heard that this expression of his, he believed that there's no real difference between a black cat and a white cat. The question is, can they catch mice? That's all we care about. A bit of a pragmatist, now believed that finally the time had come to do what he wanted to do right after the Great Leap Forward, and that is to turn China in a direction of economic modernization, allowing free market reforms to take place in a structure of political dominance by the Communist Party. And that would begin in the 1980s. That would begin with new economic zones where, to some extent at least, the free market would be allowed to work. And the result, Deng hoped, and this would in fact be the case, would be unprecedented economic growth. A society and an economy that had been held back by incompetence and murderousness and high levels would now have a chance at last to grow. And we all know what the result of that would be. I'll just give you a couple pictures here. The first slide I'll show you. There's Nixon and Zhou Enlai, of course. We'll talk about them in a minute. These are Chinese and outside Tiananmen Square mourning the death of Mao. That's September 1976. And this is the slide I wanted to show you. This is Shenzhen. This is what the area outside of Hong Kong looked like at the death of Mao, this and 4 years later. This is a 1980 slide of a little place called Shenzhen, not far from Hong Kong. And Deng Xiaoping thought, it's pretty close to Hong Kong, why not make that one of our new economic zones? We'll encourage trade between the mainland in Hong Kong, and we'll see what happens. We'll see what the free market can do. Well, you know what the free market did. That's 1980, and this next slide is 2014.
Oh, my God.
It's the same thing, same place. That's Shenzhen today.
At least it has water still.
Yeah, that's a famous park. That's a beautiful park in Shenzhen. So the upshot is that China, which from the year zero, let's call it, to the year 1800, for 1800 years, the most productive single place on the planet for 1,800 years, is now back where it always was. Most productive single place on the planet as of the first decade of the 21st century. But there's a lot to be told in the meantime. And so our last session, which will be next week, will be about Tiananmen Square and Deng Xiaoping's actions and the actions of the students in that fateful June of 1989.
Refreshments. So here's Dan.
Oh, yeah, thank you. Well, thanks again for coming, and thanks, as always, to the friends of the Bedford Public Library for doing as much as they do and providing particularly delicious desserts today. So I invite you all to partake, especially at our little break, which will come along in 45 or 50 minutes or so. We don't have a clock up here anymore. What happened to the clock?
Behind the door.
So behind the door?
Yeah.
Okay, I have no idea of knowing what time it is, but... Oh, it does, I can look right back there. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, the topic for today is the series of events that happened in the years following the Great Leap Forward, in which, as we saw last time, Mao has suffered a real loss of stature and prestige, especially among his high-level fellows in the Communist Party in Beijing. The Great Leap Forward had been not just a humanitarian disaster, but also a real economic disaster. And anybody in the know, especially in Beijing, knew what a catastrophe it had been. So after 1962, just for a while, Mao was in a state of semi-eclipse in Beijing. He had certainly not retired from his positions at the head of the party, but he was not engaged, as he had been before, in the day-to-day operations of the government. Deng Xiaoping, who we'll meet later as the ruler of China as much as anybody was in the 1980s, Liu Shaoqi, who was one of Mao's comrades on the Long March and would help persuade him to give up the worst of the Great Leap Forward programs, and especially General Lin Pao, all three of those men began to administer the state to a far greater extent than they had before the Great Leap Forward, while Mao went back into a certain kind of semi-retirement. But he was always prepared to reassert himself at the head of affairs in China, and the way he proposed to do it would be the series of events known as the Cultural Revolution, which is what we'll talk about today. And so our story for today begins in the middle of the 1960s, 1964, 1965 or so, as Mao was wondering, why had the Great Leap Forward failed? Why had it been that China did not emerge as a leading industrial power the way he had planned it to, as a consequence of the five-year plan that gave rise to the Great Leap Forward? And we know the reasons for that. The whole program was mismanaged from the beginning, and it was also very badly conceived. But in Mao's mind, that could not be the explanation. Mao had come to believe in his own cult of personality. The idea that he could be wrong, and monstrously wrong, about something was not something he was going to easily admit. And so he came to believe that the problem in China, the problem that had given rise to the disasters of the Great Leap Forward, was not economic in nature, not political in nature, but rather cultural in nature. China, Mao began to feel, was too addicted to old ways of thinking, pre-communist ways of acting and thinking that for him now had to be eradicated. And to eradicate those old ways was to restore Mao to a position of eminence in China, as he believed he was born to exercise, and to achieve that destruction of the old ways of thinking, old ways of acting. He was going to take advantage of the young people of China, people in their teens and early 20s, who he believed could be absolutely loyal to him, who would have no loyalty to the traditional communist bureaucracy that had arisen since 1949, who would have no loyalty to those among Mao in the communist leadership, but because of years and years of the cult of personality, would have loyalty to him, to Mao. And to help cement that loyalty, by 1965, he had published this. And this is the famous Little Red Book, which you've all heard of, which one of our patrons was kind enough to bring in. This is actually a 1966 English language edition of the Little Red Book with a foreword by General Lin Pao, who had helped win the Civil War on behalf of the communists in the 1940s, and who was Mao's second in command by the middle of the 1960s. So this was the book that contained most of what Mao wanted to say, especially to the young. And the idea was all wisdom, all political knowledge that matters would be contained in this book. And a central part of the cult of personality was now not just going to be the image of Mao, which you see in this poster from 1966, but also the sayings of Mao contained in the famous Little Red Book, which we'll get back to in a little while. So in 1966, Mao launched this war, as it really was, against the four olds, as he put it. Old thoughts, old culture, old customs, old habits. All of which amounted to what he thought as the same thing, ways of dragging China down from where China had to be under Mao's leadership. Everything had to be centered on Mao's personality and thoughts, printed, as I said, here in the Little Red Book, which was printed in over a billion copies in the middle of the 1960s, one of the largest printings of any book in the history of the world, distributed all over China so that everybody would have the opportunity of having one, along with 2 billion badges distributed all over China, bearing the likeness of Mao's own face to be worn preferably by everybody. The Little Red Book would come to be such an object of veneration in some parts of China, especially among the young, that it was said to be able to cure illnesses. And in one case, was credited with allowing a man to rise from the dead. One case, at least, that we know of that was published in the newspapers. Telephone operators now, at the beginning of the Cultural Revolution, this restoration of the height of Mao's cult of personality in opposition to any who might challenge him in the communist state of China. Telephone operators would be told to answer the phone by saying, "Long live Chairman Mao." Mao's portrait would be in every workplace, and workers would be taught to bow 3 times before the portrait, before beginning work. And that's why the movement had come to be known as the Cultural Revolution, a way of changing habits and thoughts among the people of China so that loyalty to Mao would be unquestioned, and only then, Mao believed, could the country go forward as he had planned for it to do in the Great Leap Forward. The idea was to exclude the leading members of the Communist Party in China to avoid what Mao thought of as the mistakes Khrushchev had made in the Soviet Union, elevating the bureaucracy of the Communist Party over the old cult of personality that Stalin had established. We want none of that in China, Mao believed. The thing to do would be to go off in a Maoist direction where all loyalty would be centered on him. And indeed, communists who Mao thought were not sufficiently dedicated to him would be specific targets of the movement to come. All over China, local officials, communist officials, would come under heavy criticism. Mao's allies would now go, beginning in 1966, to the universities, such as Beijing University, and to the high schools, and start rousing the students there to organize into groups that became known as Red Guards. The Red Guards would then be urged to draw up posters praising Mao and criticizing anybody seeking to hold on to the four olds, the old ways that Mao was not combating, and especially members of the Communist Party who supposedly were not doing what Mao wanted. They would be targets of special criticism and attack. Vast numbers of young people all over China now joined these Red Guards, new organizations of students that came to be formed in 1966. In Shanghai, 2.7 million kids joined, putting up 88,000 posters all over Shanghai in the surrounding area. In Xi'an, the great northwestern city of Xi'an in China, so many posters went up criticizing local officials that one girl who was writing 20 posters a day, all by herself, committed suicide under the strain. The Cultural Revolution would always be known for these posters, the works often of the Red Guard, and supposed to dedicate, to demonstrate their loyalty to Mao and loyalty to the principles of the Little Red Book. And the language of these posters had a certain roughness to them, a certain coarseness to them, as Red Guard models also did when they were shouting them in their harangues against people that they were opposing. The Chinese language is one of great subtlety and elegance, and to experience the coarseness of some of the language of the Red Guard in the posters could be very jolting if you respected the Chinese language the way it traditionally is. For example, one of the mottos of the Red Guard was, "Beat to a pulp any and all persons who go against Chairman Mao thought." Now, here again was the violence, a renewed sense of violence in China that came naturally to Mao, who had always said, for example, that a revolution is not a dinner party. If you wanted to make a new China, it could only be done violently. And that, in essence, was what the Red Guards took to heart, that message. By allying the youth of China to himself, Mao hoped to do a demonstrable revolutionary transformation in the entire country, in which he would be at the center of all things for good. And to demonstrate that he was capable of leading the youth of China, Mao took his famous swim in the Yangtze River in 1966. Oop, to show how youthful he was, we'll get to that poor guy in a minute. And here's Mao in the Yangtze. Mao, remember, was somebody who did swim and was proud of his swimming capacity. And to show how youthful he was at the age of 73, how strong he was, in 1966, he took this swim in the Yangtze. And he claimed to have swum across the river, which would have been a real trick. It's a really, really wide river, the Yangtze. And he probably didn't do more than a few strokes of the backstroke, which is what he was accustomed to doing, or the side stroke. But there he is in the Yangtze, and that picture was circulated all over China to show the youthfulness of Mao and his worthiness in leading the youth, the Red Guards of China, against the bureaucratic, entrenched communist hierarchy that Mao now distrusted and wanted to assert supremacy over. So to energize this movement, Mao's operatives suspended all classes in the universities and secondary schools of China so that a total of 103 million students were free to go into action as Red Guards. And what they did at universities all over China, they mobilized, and these students would seize their teachers and often stick pointed dunce caps on their heads, or sometimes waste paper baskets. And this is sort of what it could look like. This guy here is not a teacher. He's a functionary in Harbin, in Manchuria. But the idea was to humiliate them, to demean them, and to punish them for holding on to any remnant of the old ways of China, the four olds that the Cultural Revolution was dedicated against. And sometimes the teachers were made to kneel while the students kicked them, splattered their faces with black ink on occasion, pulled their hair, stuck posters on their bodies, the posters that the students had made proclaiming the thought of Chairman Mao and the virtues of the Cultural Revolution. And then the teachers would be paraded around in disgrace. Many were then forced to clean toilets at the high school or the university, wherever they had been seized. And this was a terrible thing in Chinese culture, where teachers are enormously respected in the heritage of China. For this to happen to a teacher was unprecedented and humiliating in the extreme. And the teachers who were forced to clean restrooms were the lucky ones. The most unlucky ones might be some of those, for example, who were made to sit on crates of explosives, which were then set on fire so that the arms and legs of teachers would be burst in all directions. They would be retrieved later, some of them, from treetops, limbs of teachers. Now, all attempts to bring the Red Guards under some sort of central control were from the very beginning fruitless. Mao's idea was to create chaos, to shake up China, as he thought had to be happened, through chaotic conditions. And what he thought was something better, something good, something not just centered on him, but something that would allow the genuine modernization of China would come out of that chaos. And this is what he said: great chaos will lead to great order. The demons and monsters will come out by themselves, meaning anybody who might be a threat. All restrictions must be smashed to pieces, he said. We must not restrict the masses. In other words, people in their teens and 20s were now going to be unleashed to do more or less as they pleased, according to the Little Red Book, which was in the hands of every member of the Red Guard throughout the Cultural Revolution. And as these events began, unprecedented events, Zhou Enlai did his best to stay in the background, hoping to escape any bad consequences that might have come from opposing Mao. But other members of the party, like Deng Xiaoping and Liu Shaoqi, as we'll see, were not so lucky. Now, that summer of 1966, Mao appeared periodically, regularly in Tiananmen Square in front of rallies of hundreds of thousands of Red Guards who would be brought there from all over China in great bus trips so they could see the hero, the great helmsman, Chairman Mao. And as he appeared in front of great crowds, he always wore the red armbands of the Red Guard, and off to the side, made to wear those armbands and looking very sheepish, would be Liu Shaoqi and Deng Xiaoping. And speaking to the crowds was very often Mao's wife. Zheng Cheng met a Mao, who we'll meet in just a minute, and she was a true believer in the Cultural Revolution. There she is on the left. Madame Mao was Mao's fourth wife, I believe. He married her in Yan'an during the war against Japan. He had divorced his third wife, even though his third wife had been injured by one of Chiang Kai-shek's bombs during the Long March. He divorced her and married Zheng Cheng. And she was a former actress and known in her time as a beautiful and accomplished woman. But she was also a woman who held grudges, she held very strong grudges. And Deng Xiaoping, back in Yan'an, had stood up for Mao's third wife. And Madame Mao, Zheng Cheng, never forgot that. And another thing she did not like was Liu Shaoqi had a beautiful wife himself, and she was a little bit jealous of Madame Liu, and that was going to account for some very vicious actions against both Madame Liu and Liu Shaoqi, who had been for a long time at Mao's right hand at the very summit of Chinese communist rule. This would be Zheng's chance to take revenge against those she didn't like, and she seized full advantage of that. Many thought of her as a scorpion, but she could not be disturbed as long as Mao supported her. And when she was addressing huge crowds in Tiananmen Square, she was really in her element. Remember, she was a former actress. And she would talk so that her eyes would seem to pop open with excitement as she was addressing the Red Guards. And her voice would rise to a great shriek, churning the crowd into fits of anger and resentment against all those that Madame Mao didn't like. And just to make sure that she would not be embarrassed by her shady past as an actress back in Shanghai, long before she met Mao, anyone who knew her back then were harassed, arrested, and sometimes tortured. And luckily for her former husband, who was still alive and probably would have been killed during the Cultural Revolution, he was safe in Paris running a restaurant. He didn't have to worry about it, but a lot of other people did. And one thing about her was she got to be in charge of publishing in China during the Cultural Revolution. Nothing was going to get published in China without her say-so. This was published a lot. Friedrich Engels' book was published a lot, but not a whole lot else besides that. A grand total of 124 novels were published in China between 1966 and 1971. That's it. Very little was published, but this was really all you need as far as she was concerned and as far as her husband were concerned, because they were against, according to the jargon of the Cultural Revolution, anything old. So street names were now going to be changed. Anti-revisionism Road was the sample of a new street name you might come across in China. Revisionism being the Khrushchev idea that instead of worshiping a personality, we should get down to the business of building a socialist state. But that was, of course, everything that Mao now opposed, that kind of revisionism. So you saw street names like that. Hong Kong, still in British hands, of course, was now renamed Exile the Imperialist City, or Expel the Imperialist City. Buildings in Shanghai were stripped of carvings, beautiful Art Deco carvings that had been put there in the 1930s. They were foreign, they were old, and they had to go. Mao had been taking English lessons. He stopped that during the Cultural Revolutions. No need for that now. And if a woman was caught with a Western hairstyle, Red Guards would drag her to the barbers and have her hair forcibly cut. So many Red Guards went out to the countryside to attack anything old that the trains in China were now clogged with people going back and forth for political purposes, so that by some measures, 10 million tons of goods were just sitting on the tracks during parts of 1966 and 1967. They couldn't get anywhere to the people who needed them because so many political operatives were going back and forth. Many suspected of having bourgeois, anti-communist, pro-Soviet, pro-Khrushchev sympathies were simply killed. Nobody knows how many, but we do know that in Shanghai, 700 people killed themselves rather than be killed by the Red Guards. I'm gonna beat them to it. The Red Guards were terrorizing the city in 66 and 67, and so there were 700, and at least 700 suicides. And in Tientsin, the great city to the east of Beijing, Tientsin, people routinely threw themselves in the river to die rather than be killed by the Red Guards. So many of them that people were taking fish hooks, putting them in the river and getting out the bodies before they could clog the stream. That's how bad it got to be by the end of 66. Tens of thousands who were not killed were publicly humiliated, beaten in front of great crowds by screaming Red Guards. Nobody was safe. The governor of one province had all his hair torn out for daring to wear it in a style associated with Mao during his days of the Long March. Any sign of non-communism was in trouble. In Harbin, Manchuria, the great Buddhist temple there, where monks had been worshiping for thousands of years, was now the scene of a terrible event, where those same monks who were still at the temple were dragged out and made to carry banners reading, "To hell with the Buddha." The Buddha, his writings are full of dog farts. That's what the banner had to say. And that's the kind of coarseness that those banners too often had that was shocking to people who appreciated Chinese. Children were informing upon their parents. That's the chaos that Mao had not brought into being. And if you owned precious artwork, old artwork from traditional Chinese culture, that was a sign that you were disloyal. That was a sign that you might not be able to be trusted. Red Guards raided apartments where art might be kept. They seized it, they destroyed it. But a lot of it, as we now know, was sent up to Beijing for Madame Zhang, who now sold it on the international market at a profit. Places of great historical value were attacked, vandalized. The birthplace of Confucius, Shandong province, was vandalized. 6,000 pieces of art destroyed at the great monument to Confucius, the great tomb of Confucius in Shandong. The Forbidden City itself in Beijing, the great Forbidden City, the seat of the emperors, would likely have been destroyed as well had not Zhou Enlai, in a rare bit of defiance, had soldiers there to guard it. And he preserved the Forbidden City for all of us to see. But 400,000 people branded as enemies of Mao, Rhinists, as they were called, were forced to leave the cities and live in the countryside, while the Red Guards took over the apartments that they had to vacate. And artists especially were now forced to devote all their efforts to celebrating the regime. So I'll give you some idea of the kind of thing that happened to people, the kind of people who suffered. This is Liu Shaoqi. We'll meet him in a little while. He's on the right. Every event like this has got to have some kind of scapegoat, some kind of an enemy that you can point to. When Stalin was purging the Communist Party in the Soviet Union, Trotsky was his enemy. Everybody was a Trotskyist. And in the Cultural Revolution, Liu Shaoqi, he's going to be the enemy who would now be stripped of his positions and would be the scapegoat of everything that went wrong, and some awful stuff, as we'll see, was about to happen to him. And then you didn't have to be, of course, an art lover to be horrified by this sort of thing. These are bits of painting on Chinese furniture. And this is the sort of thing that routinely happened. You come across a painting like this as a Red Guard, and you scrape it out, you deface it, you blot it out somehow, and you make sure that its true beauty could never be appreciated again. These are one of the many examples of cultural vandalism that we still have access to and that you can still see. One of many I could hundreds, perhaps thousands of temples, for example, were utterly destroyed. And the tragedy for human beings, of course, was quite as great and greater. This is one of China's great authors in the mid-20th century. This is Ding Ling, who was a woman, a crusader for women's rights, who had been in Yan'an with Mao, Zhou, and the rest of them during the war. And she had often criticized Mao for not taking seriously women's rights. He proclaimed women's rights, but there were very few women in positions of power in the Communist Party. And she had the courage to take him to task for that. She wrote novels. She actually won the Stalin Prize, highest prize in the communist world, in the middle of the 1950s. But she was an intellectual, and so during the Cultural Revolution, she was mercilessly subjected to constant Red Guard harangues, which she had to endure for hours. And what they would do is they would make you assume the airplane position. That's the airplane position. You have to hold out your arms like this, sometimes for hours. If you couldn't keep them up, they would just hit them up for you and beat you if you couldn't take the stress in the pain. And she had to do that for extended periods of time, spent 5 years in jail. And this is her long after she was finally released when the Cultural Revolution was over. And there are many examples of that. An opera star back in Shanghai, somebody that Madame Mao knew, Jiang Cheng, somebody that she knew, she really wanted revenge against her because of something she had done back in the 30s. So she found out where this opera star happened to be living in semi-retirement, and she vandalized, made sure the house was vandalized. The opera star lost her job, which was in the performing arts, and instead of performing the task that she thought she was suited for, she was now made to be a common servant, a common cleaner of houses. And eventually, she couldn't stand it. And like so many others, she made one last meal for her son and then walked to another part of the house and killed herself because of the demeaning nature of what had to happen to her. And this is Lao She. Lao She was a respected novelist and historian, journalist in China. And he was 67 years old, an intellectual during the Cultural Revolution, when he was taken by the Red Guards to a courtyard of a former Buddhist temple. He was very sick at this time, but they took him to the courtyard of the temple anyway. And there he was made to stand up in stifling heat in the airplane position while Red Guards whipped him with leather straps, spit on him for untold hours. And when he finally went home, the blood on his clothes was so thickly congealed that his wife had to cut it off with a knife. That's how bad it was. He was 67 years old. And they told him that he now had to go around town with a banner proclaiming himself a counter-revolutionary. Had to go around counter-revolutionary. And he couldn't stand the humiliation, so when he got the next chance, he walked out towards a nearby lake, walked in, and drowned himself. And here's somebody else whose story is particularly poignant. And this is a woman who was much younger during the Cultural Revolution. I think she was in her 30s or maybe early 40s. This is a Zhang Jiqin, who was a party worker, a bit of a part-time author, and also somebody with her own mind, somebody known as a person of learning, who was imprisoned by the Red Guards in solitary confinement. And she had the courage to talk back to the Red Guards. She had no use for the Cultural Revolution. She had no use for Mao back then, and she made her views known. And as a result, the Red Guards told the guards at the jail that they would be rewarded by torturing her and raping her, which they did repeatedly while she was imprisoned. And in the end, she would not recant. This is what she said. "It is better to live with honesty than with flattery. I've never thought in my life of enslaving anybody, so I won't let anybody degrade me." She stood up for herself until the end, until Madame Mao ordered her to be executed. And they were afraid she would speak on the way to be shot. So what they had to do was break her jaw on the way to the execution. And she was finally beheaded, actually, in 1975, at the very, very end of Madame Mao and Mao's rule. She is now a bit of a heroine among dissidents in China as an example of what you have to live up to. Somebody who somehow found the courage to speak her mind despite everything. And there she is. We should try to remember her. That's Zhang Jiqin. Now, all of these decisions are often made on the ground where people were whipped, where they were beaten, often killed. All of these decisions were often made in a very decentralized way. Sometimes Madam Ma would give the orders, but it was usually Red Guards just deciding what they wanted to do, and things would just get out of hand depending how they were feeling. And the question always is, why? Why would all this anger, violent anger, be coming up from the young, by people in their teens and early 20s? And one must remember that they had all grown up, ever since the 1940s, with images of Mao as the faultless statesman, the great helmsman. They believed, perhaps, having been raised with this idea, that he was infallible, could do no wrong. That's the success of the cult of personality. Many of them had grown up, especially when they were in their early teens, perhaps, in conditions of near starvation, hardship. Who are they going to blame for lack of prospects in life? Who are they going to blame for the terrible things that they'd often had to experience during the Great Leap Forward? If you can't blame Mao, you blame the people that Mao blames. And perhaps they felt that this was a way to shake up those above them and maybe make things easier for them as they were rising in life. It was all too easy, perhaps, to credit that what Mao said might be true. And so they acted. And that's when we finally get to Liu Shaoqi, who I showed you just a little while ago. He's going to be the Trotsky of the Cultural Revolution. He's going to be the one Mao's really going to blame. And finally, his time came in 1967 when he was arrested, having been denounced by his own daughter. His own daughter put up a poster nearby their apartment saying, "Witness the despicable soul of Liu Shaoqi," who had been at Mao's side ever since the Long March. He was forced to stand up for hours while the Red Guard harangued in his face, brandished the little red book in his face, spit in his face sometimes. They would not let him sleep. They shouted at all hours towards his bedroom window while dozens of people were found to testify that Liu Shaoqi was an American agent. Not a shred of documentary evidence, despite 2 million documents being gone through, ever said anything of the kind or shown anything of the kind. But he was denounced this way, finally imprisoned, and at the same time, Madam Mao has special plans for his wife, who, remember, she didn't like Madam Liu, known to be an attractive woman, who had gone abroad with Liu Shaoqi on visits to various heads of state. And on one of those trips, she went to Indonesia, and she wore one of the traditional tight-fitting Chinese silk dresses. And Madam Mao did not like the idea that she was wearing this beautiful tight-fitting silk dress, traditional in China. And so she decided to punish Madam Liu for trying, perhaps, to assert herself as somebody greater, more graceful than Madam Mao herself. And so what happened to Madam Liu, who Mao had known, by the way, for about 20 years, what happened to her was she was taken by the Red Guards. She was forced down on the floor. And against her will, they took off what she was wearing, and they tried to fit that same silk red dress on her, forcibly and violently. And then what they did was they took her outside, where there were about 10,000 Red Guards gathered in the square, and they shouted at her while she froze in that thin silk dress in the winter of 1967. And all of it orchestrated for vengeance, petty vengeance, by Madam Mao. "You have violated Chairman Mao's instructions about not struggling against the people," the Red Guard said. And they even attacked her for daring to light a cigarette for the president of Indonesia. That's somehow, perhaps, showing that she was getting too big for her own britches, as we might say in this country. And for that, she was punished. And eventually, her husband was sent out on the countryside to work for a while. Then he was brought back to prison. Madam Liu, Liu Shaoqi, they were both in prison for a while. They're in the same prison, but they weren't allowed to see each other until one particular day came when they just happened to be out exercising at the same time, and Madam Liu rushed to embrace her husband one last time, for she knew he was sickening. She knew he was dying. And they were clearly separated by the guards after a last moment of embrace. Liu Shaoqi was put on trial. He only had 7 teeth left by then. He was very sick, and he was denounced by all hands as a terrible traitor, even though there's no evidence of that. He broke down and he died before they could execute him after a trial that was televised all over a fascinated China. Madam Liu survived until she was 85. She only died in 2006, long after her husband, Liu Shaoqi, was resurrected by the modern Communist Party as somebody who was much better than Mao said he was. But almost nobody dared to protest. Now, one of the few examples other than her, that I found of somebody who actually directly protested and tried to indicate their hatred for what was happening in China was a young woman named Wang Rongfen. And she'd been studying German. And that made her a target of the Red Guards. You're studying German, you're studying foreign things. And so naturally she was going to get into trouble. But before she could, she actually wrote a letter to Mao. So 1967, she wrote a letter to Mao. And she told him that the Cultural Revolution was not a mass movement. The Cultural Revolution was a case of the masses being tricked and brutalized and had to stop. And she said that this is a case of one man manipulating the people, that is Mao. And she told Mao in this letter, you're no better than Hitler. You're no better than Hitler. And she signed in her name. And she mailed the letter. And after she mailed the letter, she went and she found a bunch of insecticide. And there was plenty of insecticide in China because they were used against the pest during the Great Leap Forward. She found a bunch of insecticide. And she walked over to the Soviet embassy. And in front of the Soviet embassy, she took all the insecticide and she drank it in an attempt to commit suicide. She drank 4 bottles of insecticide. But her suicide attempt failed. She was tortured and thrown in jail. But she wasn't killed, and she finally got out of the 1980s. Well, the list of atrocities during the Cultural Revolution goes on, but one thing that did happen that was quite unusual was Mao's great enemy by now really was the Soviet Union. And he was terrified that the Soviet Union would invade, attack China. And the Red Guards were taught that the Soviet Union is the real enemy. They're the ones who revised communism. They're the ones who've lost the true force of communism the way it could be if the masses had genuinely rallied behind a great leader. And so the Soviets were the ones who had to look out their embassy every day and see Red Guards parading and parading and shouting at them and shouting at them. If you were a Soviet diplomat, you'd have tires slashed repeatedly if you were dumb enough to leave the car out in the street. And so if you were in the Soviet embassy, you almost never left the embassy now. As long as the Cultural Revolution was going on, you stayed in the embassy as long as you could, barely went out at all. But it wasn't just them. It was also the British embassy in Beijing. Now, the British consul in Shanghai was hit by Red Guards, spat on, and smeared with glue after the consulate in Shanghai was ransacked by Red Guards. But it was even worse in Beijing, where the embassy was. The Red Guards were furious that Hong Kong was still a British possession, among other things. So what they decided to do was blockade the embassy, laid under siege. And the personnel at the embassy were used to not going outside. Now they're under siege, hoping that the diplomats work this out somehow. But finally, the Red Guards, just as the Iranians did in 1979 to our embassy, the Red Guards decided to attack the British embassy in Beijing. And the British personnel were in there. They're watching a movie. They were playing bridge. They had a bunch of file cabinets up against the door, but it didn't do any good. The attack came. They got into the embassy shouting, kill, 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 kill. And they took members of the embassy into their custody, beat them up. They found the senior official there, the senior guy who happened to be at the embassy. And they, after beating him badly with a bamboo stake, the Red Guards made him stand in a box outside in front of a bunch of people. And they told him to shout, long live Chairman Mao. Long live Mao. You shout, long live Mao. Long live Mao. And he wouldn't do it. So long live Mao. He wouldn't do it. Very brave guy. He kept refusing to do so. So they dragged him through the streets, and he thought he was going to die. Thought they were probably going to kill him. They dragged him through the streets, as it turned out, to the Albanian embassy, one of Mao's few good friends in the world, Albania. And that's where they left him. And the whole time he was being dragged by the Red Guards, he was trying to calm himself, and he recited passages from the Aeneid. He recited Virgil all the way down towards the Albanian embassy, which gives us another reason why education is a good thing. It will help you in these times. It will help you when you are under great stress to remind yourself of the great figures of the past. And he survived, as did a lot of other lucky people. Now, embassies being attacked. The last time embassies were attacked in Beijing was 1898. And that was the Boxer Rebellion. And the last time this happened, Germany, Japan, the United States, Great Britain, France, they all sent armies into China to punish them for this. But this is 1967. It's not going to happen now. China was too powerful, and so the Red Guards got away with this. The only people who were in a position to stop this were Mao himself, if he decided that it was time, and also the army, the Chinese army. And what happened by late 67, early 68, was the army was getting nervous about all this. The Red Guard was in control of much of China, and the army believed that it was getting to a point where maybe the Red Guard could not be put back in that box if Mao ever thought that was a good idea. Liu Shaoqi was in jail, about to be executed, although he died before that could happen. Deng Xiaoping was now sent to work in a tractor factory. Ironically, he had worked in a tractor factory back in France 50 years before when he was traveling there. Now he's back in a tractor factory, hoping to learn, Mao thought, how to think like a commoner, like a peasant. But other people who were there, still around Mao, were very nervous about all this. Is there any way to control these Red Guards? And the army especially felt that the time had come, perhaps, to put a cap on this, to quell this, while there was still time. Many people had suffered by now. Consider Deng Xiaoping. His brother, down in Guizhou, killed himself because he was attacked by Red Guards. And his own son was a brilliant physicist. Deng Xiaoping had a brilliant physicist son studying at Beijing University. The Red Guards caught him, they tortured him. And at the university, he actually was running from Red Guards up on the roof. Red Guards were chasing him on the roof. He jumped off the roof to escape the Red Guards and spent the rest of his life a paraplegic because of what happened to him. And Deng Xiaoping knew this, others knew, other people that this had happened to. Members of the army had people that this sort of thing was happening to. Maybe the time had come to put a stop to this. And what finally happened was Lin Pao and the army especially came to Mao and pled that some sort of order be restored to China. And in 1968, finally Mao decided that might be a good idea by now. And the army began to go into places in China and in some cases fight battles with the Red Guard to keep them under control and to stop the worst of this chaos. And finally they did so that by 1968 and especially 1969, the Red Guards were told, leave the cities, leave the towns, go out in the countryside and help rebuild China there. 12 million Red Guards went out to the countryside. And in the meantime, the high schools, the universities, most of them were not open during all these years. And that's why, for many people, this is the lost generation of China. People who didn't get a chance to get an education, people who didn't get a chance to learn a skill. They were either Red Guards or they just couldn't go to school because the whole thing was shut down. And that would be true even into the early 1970s. But at least for the time being, the worst of the Red Guard terror was over, and the army, with eventually Mao's blessing, had reasserted control. But for his purposes, he had done it. He had rid the upper reaches of the communist echelon in Beijing of any possible opposition to him. Liu Shaoqi was dead in prison. Deng Xiaoping was still off at the tractor factory. And Zhou Enlai, as usual, was still around, but in no position even to think of challenging the great helmsman. Mao and Meta Mao now ran the state. And any loss of stature that Mao suffered after the Great Leap Forward was now very much a thing of the past. The Cultural Revolution would not officially end until just before Mao's death, but the worst of it was over by 1969, because by then the army and Mao had other things to worry about, not just the Red Guard and what they might do, but also the Soviet Union, because there were now border incidents and fighting going on between the Soviets and the Chinese on the Ussuri River and also in Xinjiang province off to the west. And if anything was going to perhaps interfere with Chinese efforts to come to grips with this new crisis, it might be disorder caused by the Red Guards. So there was now something new to worry about, and that would mean the end, finally, of the worst phases of the communist Cultural Revolution. But what I would suggest is the significance of all this is at least partly this, that disorder that the Red Guards caused, 66, 67, especially those 2 years in 68, the constant sight of uncontrolled young people brandishing the little red book into the faces of those they didn't like. A series of events that may, according to some estimates, have resulted in the deaths of 1.5 million people all over China. That disorder, that uncontrolled disorder, was never to be forgotten by the people who lived through it, some of whom would become leaders in China by the 1980s and 1990s. And the example of allowing some sort of power center, uncontrolled completely from the top, which is the case with the Red Guards, would not be repeated again. And if you wonder why the modern communist leadership is so intent upon maintaining absolute power and not allowing centers of dissent to form anywhere else in the country, the memory of the Red Guards may play a role in that insistence on maintaining stability at all costs. And so it would be that when China would alter its economy completely by the 1980s, it would do so on the understanding that was very important in Deng Xiaoping's mind, that that economic modernization would take place within the context of rigid political stability. No more opening things up. Whatever the Red Guards were, no more of that. And what is the lesson of history? We have a French Revolution because the king allowed the Estates General to form. We get an American Revolution because the king was in no position to prevent the formation of the Continental Congress. We got a Russian Revolution because we had the Soviets that were formed as workers' organizations that would control communications and industry after the Tsar was toppled in 1917. In every single case, the real revolution happened because those centers of authority were there that resentment could rally around. And that's what the Red Guards might have been. Mao himself was worried that the Red Guards would get a taste of power and maybe turn against him someday. And to stop that, to nip that in the bud, they had to go. And here we have again the answer to what many people wonder. Why not allow some center of dissent in China, some organized, independent political activity? Why not loosen things up? Because that might be the signal for something very deep. That might be a signal for revolution. You give people a way to rally that's legal, and they'll take it. And the Red Guards would be a living and very close reminder of what happens when you let slip just a little bit central authority. It can happen again. So we have to cover the question of what happened to Mao. He died in 1976 under very interesting circumstances. So I thought I would talk a bit about that after you get a chance to have some sweets. Have some coffee, have some sweets. Yeah, very much. In the big picture, not such a bad idea. If you wanted genuine equality and revolution, maybe you did have to begin with culture. Maybe you did have to re-educate people. Maybe you did have to take people and have them do odd jobs and menial tasks and get them to think in a certain way. And it was not all that unusual, at least for a while, to go into a rather radical student's dorm room and maybe see not just a poster of Che Guevara, which was more likely, but maybe a poster of Mao. And there were faculty members who thought that maybe Mao had the genuine revolutionary potential that no longer could be sought for in the Soviet Union, for example. But for a few of those, the atrocities of the Cultural Revolution were well known. You knew what was going on. You knew the sayings of Mao. You knew the basic program. But the worst of it was underreported in the West. Few people knew just how bad it was until a little bit later. And it was bad. Those were years when middle schools were turned into prisons in some parts of China, when the words "Long Live Mao" were sometimes written in the blood of those who were attacked on street walls and building walls in various cities. It's a tough, difficult, and treacherous time to live. But one story that always struck me as a very poignant one had to do with a Chinese doctor who had left China just before the Cultural Revolution and got his medical degree in Canada. He wanted to be an obstetrician. And so after studying a long time in Canada, by 1969, he felt he was ready to go home. And he could have stayed in Canada. He could have made some money treating women in hospitals there. But he was a patriot, and he wanted to go back to China. He wanted to work on women in China and increase the knowledge of proper birthing techniques there. So he wanted to do his duty to his own people. So he went back to China, and very shortly after he got back, at the very end of the height of the Cultural Revolution, he was arrested by Red Guards. And they decided that a good thing to do to him was to make him stay in a morgue. So he wasn't even put in a prison. He was put in a morgue where it's freezing cold. And he wasn't given much to wear. And for years, he had to live at the morgue, surrounded by these dead bodies. And he felt that he could prevent himself from freezing to death if he could just find shrouds here and there. He was dressing himself as best he could. But what he was really afraid of was going crazy, because he couldn't leave the morgue. And so what he would do is he would, every night, when the other workers had left, he would get up on a table, and he would stomp around a bit to keep himself warm. And the whole time he was on the stable, he would keep reciting in English the Gettysburg Address. So 47 years ago, our fathers. So he knew the Gettysburg Address. He'd just keep reciting it. And he stayed sane doing that. And that kind of thing should never happen to anybody. When your talents can't be put to use. You're put in the morgue, you got to stand at a table, and you got to keep your own sanity. That's a sign of a society that has taken a wrong turn. In this case, led, unfortunately, by Mao. So when the army began to keep control of the Red Guards and when the worst of these upheavals were over by the early 1970s, the big question remained for Mao, what about the Soviet Union? He was obsessed with fear that the Soviets would subject China to a nuclear attack. He had a big bunker built for himself. Once he actually had Beijing evacuated by all officials because he thought a nuclear strike was imminent from the Soviet Union. And there was fighting on the border, and the Chinese actually captured a top secret Soviet T-62 tank on the island on the Missouri River during one of his engagements. And the United States was paying a very close attention to that. And that is the origin of the famous rapprochement between the United States and China. Mao decided he needed the United States as a counterweight to China, to the Soviet Union, at the same time that we felt we needed the Chinese as a counterweight to the Soviets, and maybe a way to get a decent settlement in Vietnam. So maybe if we could get closer to China, we could play them off against the Soviets look up against the Chinese, and they both had influence over North Vietnam, and maybe that would be a way to try to get a peace deal. And that's one reason Nixon made his famous visit to China, which everybody watched on TV, one of the most famous events of 1972. By then, however, something really big had happened. Lin Pao, who had been Mao's right-hand man, who had written the foreword to the Little Red Book, and who was supposed to be Mao's successor, had come under a great deal of suspicion from Madame Mao, and there was some talk of him maybe getting arrested and maybe him being the latest casualty of this Cultural Revolution. And for one reason or another, he got in an airplane, left Beijing, and nobody knows what happened next. The wreck of the plane was found in Mongolia. The plane crashed, maybe on the way to the Soviet Union. Maybe he was defecting, but maybe he was on his way to Taiwan and taking a roundabout route. We still don't know to this day what he was up to. But he went down in a plane crash before he could be arrested, before Madame Mao could have her way. And now the great question was, who's going to succeed Mao? He was sick. Among other things, he had a venereal disease because he was quite reckless with younger women. I had no problem infecting them long after he knew he had venereal disease. And he also had Parkinson's disease. He had lung problems. The month before he actually met Nixon, he had a stroke. He was in terrible health, even by the early 1970s. And everybody knew he's not going to live forever. Now, who's going to succeed him? And many people in China thought the logical choice was Zhou Enlai. Zhou Enlai had suffered during the Cultural Revolution, too. His two adopted children were murdered by the Red Guards. But many people in China respected Zhou Enlai. His wife could not have children, but Zhou Enlai loved her, would not divorce her. Liu Shaoqi, Mao, they're all multi-divorced. But Zhou Enlai stuck by his wife, and he was widely respected for that. And many people in China thought the worst excesses of the Great Leap Forward and even the Cultural Revolution, if you were older, of course, that was not a good time for you, might have been avoided if Zhou Enlai had been in charge. He was somebody who was looked up to. So what if he could succeed? Wow. A lot of people thought that might be such a pretty good idea. But then what happened was January 1976, while this man, Deng Xiaoping, was still off at the tractor, well, he was actually renovated by now. He was back in Beijing, but didn't have any power. He was living on his own. While Deng Xiaoping was out of the tractor factory, Zhou Enlai died January 1976. And after he died, 3 months later, during the Great Xingming Festival, where all over China, in the first week of April, people commemorate their ancestors, those who they love, who are no longer with us. They commemorate them by decorating tombs and lighting bits of paper on fire. You've probably seen some of the Qingming Festival. What a lot of people in Beijing did was they went to Tiananmen Square, and they left monuments to Zhou. It's 3 months after he died. And Madame Mao ordered that those monuments be cleaned up. She got them all out. It's just trash. She had no use for Zhou Enlai. Madame Mao wanted to succeed Mao herself. And so what happened next was, this is an example of the Qingming Festival. What happened next was when people noticed that all that stuff had been cleaned out of Tiananmen Square, by some estimates, the next day, early April 1976, 2 million people at one time or another went into Tiananmen Square and protested. Nothing like this had happened since 1949. Mass protests against mostly Madame Mao and the idea that she might succeed the chairman. So here was not an uprising, but something close to it. And Madame Mao had to order in the troops, and there was bloodshed in the square, as there would be again in 1989. But that seemed to indicate that Madame Mao was not too popular, and that gave rise to the hopes of Deng Xiaoping. It can't be long now. When Mao died, who's going to succeed? And a man named Hua Guofeng was chosen at almost the last minute by Mao. But he was a bit of a non-entity. Nobody knew much about him. And that's why Madame Mao thought in the end that she would probably take charge. But what ultimately happened was Mao, in September of 1976, did die. He needed desperately the attention of top-flight ultra-modern medicine. And Madame Mao didn't believe in any of that. And so he didn't get the attention that he really needed by then. And he died in the second week of September 1976. And almost immediately, Hua Guofeng, within a month, was able to seize control. Ned and Mao and the rest of what came to be called the Gang of Four were arrested, eventually put on trial, and 2 years later, because Ho Guo Fang wasn't much of a charismatic personality, Deng Xiaoping, by 1978, could take charge himself. And the rest is history. Deng, famous for saying, you probably all heard that this expression of his, he believed that there's no real difference between a black cat and a white cat. The question is, can they catch mice? That's all we care about. A bit of a pragmatist, now believed that finally the time had come to do what he wanted to do, right after the Great Leap Forward, and that is to turn China in a direction of economic modernization, allowing free market reforms to take place in a structure of political dominance by the Communist Party. And that would begin in the 1980s. That would begin with new economic zones where, to some extent at least, the free market would be allowed to work. And the result, Deng hoped, and this would in fact be the case, would be unprecedented economic growth. A society and an economy that had been held back by incompetence and murderousness and high lows would now have a chance at last to grow. And we all know what the result of that would be. I'll just give you a couple pictures here. The first slide I'll show you. There's Nixon and Zhou Enlai, of course. We'll talk about them in a minute. These are Chinese and outside Tiananmen Square mourning the death of Mao. That's September 1976. And this is the slide I wanted to show you. This is Shenzhen. This is what the area outside of Hong Kong looked like at the death of Mao, this 4 years later. This is a 1980 slide of a little place called Shenzhen, not far from Hong Kong. And Deng Xiaoping thought, it's pretty close to Hong Kong, why not make that one of our new economic zones? We'll encourage trade between the mainland in Hong Kong, and we'll see what happens. We'll see what the free market can do. Well, you know what the free market did. That's 1980, and this next slide is 2014.
Oh, my God.
It's the same thing, same place. That's Shenzhen today. Yeah, that's a famous park. That's a beautiful park in Shenzhen. So the upshot is that China, which from the year zero, let's call it, to the year 1800, for 1800 years, the most productive single place on the planet for 1,800 years, is now back where it always was. Most productive single place on the planet as of the first decade of the 21st century. But there's a lot to be told in the meantime. And so our last session, which will be next week, will be about Tiananmen Square and Deng Xiaoping's actions and the actions of the students in that fateful June of 1989.